Happiness is beautiful, it's a kind of reality. Happiness is the highest good, happiness is free. So let's be so very happy. Yeah, let's be so very happy. Yeah, let's be so very happy. Welcome to the Happiness Show. This is George Ortega. I'm here to talk about happiness because happiness is, always has been, and always will be the point of it all. Today I'm going to be talking about happiness and God's justice. Okay, let's begin this show by prefacing a few facts. Basically, our world really knows what creates happiness and what doesn't. We've known this since the early 60s. You know, money generally doesn't, success, fame, education. What does create it is generally other people, knowing how to control our thoughts, being active, setting and achieving goals. I mean, this is basic knowledge that we've known for over 40 years. We've even had programs to increase our level of happiness beginning in the late 70s. Michael Fordyce, the pioneer of happiness increase research, created the first happiness increase program in 1977, and he demonstrated that after 4 to 6 weeks, he could raise his subjects' level of happiness by about 25%. Okay, the problem is that we're no happier right now than we were 50 years ago. Even though we're about 2.5 times richer, our happiness level is about 70%, which isn't all that happy. I mean, think about it. The average, we're on average, here in the United States, we're happy about half the time. You know, half of our days we're spending not being happy. And I just read some research that came out recently suggesting that in the 1930s, in the midst of the Depression, the average happiness level in the United States was actually higher than it is now. Okay, so there's definitely, you know, a problem with how happy we, not just in the United States, but in the entire world are, and how happy we could be or should be. So what's the reason? Why aren't we any happier than we are? Why aren't we as happy as we could be? Okay, I think the basic reason is that we're just not applying this knowledge. You know, we've got, again, 40 years of research, findings, all this knowledge about how to become happier, you know, how to not waste our time seeking things that we think will make us happier but actually won't. Okay, maybe there are other possible reasons, perhaps, like maybe it's just not time for the world to be happier. You know, like I would imagine hundreds of years ago we were just struggling to really survive, and you know, we had to go through that period, and now maybe we're only awakening to the idea that happiness is really what we want from life and that it's much easier than most of us realize. Maybe it's some of the myths that we've grown up with. For example, many of us believe that happiness is unattainable. I mean, you know, Freud, you know, the one of the pioneers of psychiatry, he actually thought that the happiness wasn't possible. And you know, I mean, fortunately, we have research demonstrating that 90% of us here in the United States actually are happy. About 20% are very happy. So. But these myths are ingrained. Another myth that we have is that if we seek happiness, that's the best way to lose our happiness. Again, these, you know, experiments like Fordyce's programs and others demonstrate the exact opposite. The more we value happiness and the more we seek it, the easier it is to achieve it. So these are perhaps possible reasons why we're not as happy as we could be. But this program is about what perhaps is maybe a deeper underlying reason, and that's that God's justice is limiting our happiness, especially the happiness of those of us here in the first world, the industrialized nations, who, you know, basically have so much in terms of resources, convenience, luxury, time, etc. Okay, I just want to go a bit into why I'm bringing God into this, basically, here in the United States, about 90% of us do believe in God. Half of our population actually believes that in creationism as opposed to evolution. So half of us are actually very deeply religious in their belief. Now, personally, I don't. My personal belief, I strongly believe in God. I don't believe in some of the ideas espoused by traditional conventional religions, like I don't believe that God would condemn anyone to hell eternally, etc. But again, I do have a strong belief in God. For those of us who are not religious, you know, when I say God, you can substitute the word nature, because, you know, God has certain laws, spiritual laws, like justice, you know, and I think nature has similar laws. In other words, nature has physical laws like the law of gravity. It's a physical law that, you know, objects attract each other. And I think nature also has spiritual laws. You know, sometimes we'll understand it as like what goes around comes around. That inherent in nature there is this component of justice, that we know that when we do wrong, you know, we tend to be punished, and when we do right, we're rewarded. Okay, so the theme of this show is that God or nature is really not allowing us to be as happy as we could, because we're not being as good as we could. You know, think about it. God is not going to reward us with greater happiness, which is what we really want, unless we're being very good people. Now, why aren't we being so good? Okay. In my mind, I think the greatest sin of our planet, the greatest sin especially of the industrialized nations like the United States and most of Europe, is that we're not feeding the poor. We're not coming to the assistance of the poor. There are about 800 million people that die every year of hunger and malnutrition. That's over 20,000 people dying every day, and about 18,000 of these people that die every day of hunger and malnutrition are children, and we're not helping them. One half of our planet is living on less than $3 American a day. And when I say American dollars, I mean that, like, what we can buy here in the United States with $3 is what they live on each day, okay? And you know, we simply do not help them. Let me give you an example of our indifference, our greed, our selfishness. There's a term, an economic term called gross national product. Now, basically, that is the income of the nation, how much we, everyone all together, makes each year, you know, with the products and services we sell. Okay, now how much do we donate in foreign aid as a percentage of our GNP, our gross national product? We donate 0.001%, okay? to say that that's nothing is like, I mean, it's so clear that we could and should be doing much more. To give you a comparison with something else that we spend money on to demonstrate just how little we spend on foreign aid to help feed people, we devote 4,000 times more money on our military than we devote to foreign aid. And the problem, the problem is even deeper. Most of the foreign aid that we give doesn't go to feed people that are hungry, doesn't go to help the poor. It goes for strategic reasons, for our basic self-interest. For example, we give a lot of money to Israel so that the Arabs won't invade it and conquer it. You know, a lot of the foreign aid we give is really for strategic reasons. Okay. And what's so unfortunate about this is, like, the media, our culture promotes this great myth that we here in America are so generous, when the reality couldn't be further from the truth. The University of Michigan did a study. They asked some people to tell them how much they thought of the GNP. Did we give to foreign aid? How much of our GNP do we generally spend on foreign aid? And the average response was, most people thought we'd give about 15% of our GNP to foreign aid. Okay, then they were asked, the subjects were asked, well, how much should we be giving? Okay, and the average answer was about 5%. Okay, again, we're giving 1/1000th of 1%. We're extremely greedy, extremely selfish, and God is not going to reward us with what we most want from life when we are not fulfilling our obligations, our duties to our fellow men, to humanity, and also to the planet. You know, he's just not, you know, happiness is really the only gift. You know, everything else that we get in life is really valuable because it helps us to become happier. So God, you know, God is not going to give us so much of what is really the only gift if we're not being very good. Here's, you know, I just want to explain more about like this issue, especially with Africa, where there's so much hunger, so much poverty. It's not just about our being good. It's that we have to realize we have to take responsibility for what's happening there. Our ancestors, we went into that continent. We went to, you know, here we colonized South America. We colonized, the Europeans colonized Africa, other parts of the world. And what they did was they took over their governments. You know, they just totally destroyed the functioning governments that they had there, the tribal units, the way they would live their lives, and they replaced them with these artificial boundaries, artificial nations, etc. And the problem was that before this colonization, there were occasional famines in Africa, but not nearly to the extent they are now, because most people think that, you know, that that people in Africa especially are not eating because there's not enough food. That's not the truth. The truth is because as a result of our imperialism, of our colonization, the land, so much of the land in Africa now is owned by very rich people, and these rich people, they don't use, and a lot of, you know, some of the rich people are from other parts of the world, these rich people don't use that land to feed the African people. They'll use that land to, let's say, grow coffee or grow an export crop to make money. So they're basically taking Africa's land, arable land, you know, for farming, and using that money not to benefit the people, but to benefit themselves, a very small minority of people. Okay, again, God is not going to reward that. He's not going to give us our happiness if we're being so indifferent, so callous to the needs of so many people. We create myths, you know, kind of to excuse ourselves, to kind of like, you know, say, well, we can't, you know, it's, the problem is too big. You know, it's war, it's corruption. Okay, if you want to like study the subject, if you want to read through a few books on world hunger and all, you'll understand that wars, corruption, famine represent a very, very small percentage of why there is such great hunger and poverty in the world. You know, we just tend to use these myths as convenient excuses for not basically giving of ourselves, giving of our money to help these people. Okay, and again, you know, it's evil. You know, I mean, like we talk about goodness, and when we're not good, we're really being evil. Our evil doesn't extend just to not feeding, not caring for so many people on our planet that need our help. We're not being good to the environment, and we're not being good to other forms of life. You know, constantly, life forms are being are going extinct. You know, now we have this global warming problem that will change the weather of the planet if it continues to go in the same direction. So, you know, the extent of our evil, the our basically shirking our responsibility also includes just the very welfare of the planet. Okay, and unfortunately what happens is rather than worshiping goodness as we should, because I mean we've done shows on this, Jonathan Locke, a philosopher, I think, in the 1800s, basically described goodness as what creates happiness. Okay? I mean, when we do good, the reason it's good is because it's creating happiness. So obviously, when we're not doing good, when we're doing evil, what we're doing is limiting our happiness. And again, you know, God is not going to give us allow us to be as happy as we could very easily be until we begin to assume our responsibility and become better people. You know, rather than worshiping money and power and convenience and self-interest, we've got to start worshiping God and goodness much more again. Okay, another thing is like our education system. I mean, our kids go through 12 years of school, and it's not for their best interest. I mean, basically, you know, we are teaching these kids to read and write, and we're teaching them all these skills, not really for their own good, to a certain extent for their own good, but basically we're preparing them to be effective, efficient workers in our economy once they grow up. And, you know, unfortunately, again, you know, as we become richer as a country, we don't get any happier, because happiness really isn't about money. So basically, we're putting our children through 12 years of school and not teaching them what we should be teaching. What should we be teaching them? What, you know, within these 12 years, goodness and happiness. Certainly, they have to learn how to read and write and do math and all. But, you know, if we're not teaching them how to be good people, how to contribute to the happiness of people they know and to the happiness of the world, and if we're not teaching them how to become much happier themselves, we are really neglecting our responsibility toward them. I mean, we all, our basic want is in life, what we really want, what all of us want is happiness. And to have our children go through 12 years of school and learn virtually nothing about either goodness or happiness is really, really, in my mind, criminal. You know, it's really just abusing the children, because we're teaching them what we want them to learn so that we'll benefit, you know, as adults or whatever, and we're just not teaching them what's in their best interest. Okay, so, you know, the idea is that, you know, if God is just, and I believe He is, we just don't deserve greater happiness. You know, we're not. Again, goodness creates happiness. If we're not being as good as we should, God is not going to reward us with giving us the kind of happiness that we could potentially have. Everything is in place. The knowledge is in place. The institutions are in place. We have everything that we need to become much happier, especially in the first world. But the reason we're not happier is because we're lacking that one component that's vital, and that's goodness. Okay, so what's the answer? And you know, we really should be thankful. We should be thankful that we're as happy as we are, because I think that, you know, God is actually being very merciful by allowing us for, you know, decade after decade to allow, you know, millions of people to starve when we could easily feed them, and to allow, you know, all these kinds of abuses that have been going on for many decades. So we really should be thankful. So what's the answer? The answer is, of course, we have to begin to do what's right. Not what's easy, not what's self-serving, not what's going to, you know, keep us much richer than we need to be. First thing, we have to feed the hungry. You know, this is, you know, it can't go on like this. I mean, like, you know, the politicians won't talk about it. The media, which is governed by rich people, they won't talk about it, because they're afraid that if they talk about it, they're going to be called upon to provide a lot of this money that the poor people need. And yes, that's a fact. They probably would be, but they have so much more money than they need anyhow. So it's much better that this money be used to a good cause than for them to just like waste it on luxuries and things that don't create happiness for them or for other people in the world anyhow. I think we should be fixing the food industry. Right here in the United States, I think about 2/3 of our population is actually obese. You know, you don't hear much in the media in terms of like why this is so, but think about it. You've got these food commercials, these fast food commercials, all these food commercials coming on in the evening after people will hopefully have already eaten their dinner, and they're going on throughout the whole evening, and these commercials are enticing people to eat. They're, you know, the food looks delicious, and even though a person has eaten, and is full, they may want to eat more because of these commercials, because these commercials will just induce cravings in them for food, whether it's pizza or hamburgers or whatever. So that we've got to stop this. We've got to stop allowing corporations to wreak havoc on our health and our happiness by you know, just playing with our emotions, just making us feel hungry when we're not, making us crave more food than we need. Again, we have to teach our kids the important things in life. Reading and writing and math and all certainly are necessary, but that's pretty easy to teach, and kids certainly have enough time to learn a lot about happiness. Happiness should be taught every day in school. Goodness should be taught every day, and it's not just about the schools. As parents, we have to take the responsibility to understand that it's not just enough to give our kids what they want, you know, in terms of like an iPod or a baseball mitt or CDs and stuff. If we're not giving them knowledge, if we're not giving them information to help them be good people and to help them be happy people, then again, we're shirking our responsibility. We're not giving them what they most need. Okay, something else we've got to do. Cigarettes kill people. You know, they kill people. They cost our government, our just society in general, so many millions of dollars each year. Treating people who get cancer and all these other diseases from cigarettes, they should be illegal. They should be illegal. You shouldn't be allowed to sell a product and make so much money from a product that, when used as directed, will much more likely than not either make you very sick or kill you. I mean, that's insane that our government has allowed this to happen for so long. Why do they allow it? Because too much money is controlling our politics, and that's the other thing we have to do. We have to take money out of politics. Right now, we know what the right thing to do is. We know we should be feeding people. We know we should be taking care of the Katrina victims. We know there are so many things in life that we should be doing. Why aren't we doing them? Again, because the people who control this world very often, much more often than not, are corporations and people with a lot of money that will use that money to lobby and influence society and our politics, our politicians, our government institutions to work against the public good. You know, they're indifferent, they're callous, they're cruel. And, you know, so in a certain sense, you know, our happiness is greatly limited because we're not being as good as we should be, as we could be as a world. But I think in a much more direct sense, we're not standing up to these rich corporations. We're not standing up to these rich people. We're not standing up to our politicians and demanding that they do what's right, not what some corporation, some oil company, some cigarette industry wants them to do so they can make more money. So, you know, we really have to take money out of politics, and we have to have the courage and the energy to really stand up to the people who are just preventing us from doing what's right. We've got to protect the planet. You know, this is like right now we're living for ourselves. You know, we're depleting so many of our resources, and the planet is just not nearly as clean as it could be. We're thinking of ourselves. We're not thinking of our children. We're not thinking of our grandchildren. This is certainly not good. And God is not going to reward us for being so inconsiderate of the generations that will come after us. You know, there are technologies that we have that are much cleaner in terms of providing energy. We don't utilize these technologies because the oil companies lobby against them. They won't be able to sell as much oil if we have windmills all over the place, or if we have solar cells fueling our houses. We've got to stop that. We've got to start protecting the planet. And again, that means like battling the people on our planet, the very few people actually who have a lot of money and are stopping us from doing what we should be doing. Okay. There's God may actually allow us, you know, if we're lucky, if we're fortunate, God may actually allow us to become happier before we become much better people. And the reason I say this is because happiness researchers have determined that as we, as individuals, become happier, we become better people. You know, studies confirm that as we become happier, we'll become more compassionate. We will get along better with people. We'll be more industrious, more active. We'll be healthier. So, you know, if we're not able to really assume our responsibilities and be the kind of people that we should be, you know, God willing, we will find a way to become happier, and then that greater happiness may create within us the what we need to basically do what we should be doing. Again, if God doesn't do that, if God doesn't bless us with greater happiness that will lead to the greater goodness that to feed people and protect our planet and all, then we certainly have to do it ourselves. Okay, let's see. Again, I just want to emphasize this point. We know how to become much happier. You know, the science is in place. The institutions are in place. We have much more money than we need to do this. And so, when you think of why we're not happier, you have to really understand that you know, God created this world. God rules this world. God determines what happens and what doesn't. And you know, God expects us to behave well. God expects us to be good, and He is not going to give us what we most want from life unless we become the kind of people that we should, unless we feed the poor, feed the hungry, and care for our environment, and do so many other things that we should be doing. Okay, well, that's all we have time for today. Thanks for watching. In the future, we'll explore other topics designed to help us better enjoy life. This is George Ortega saying, be good, think well, feel very happy, and I hope you join us again next time here on The Happiness Show.
Happiness is powerful. It's our underlying need. Happiness is why we live each day. Happiness is destiny. So let's be so very happy. Yeah, let's be so very happy. Yeah, let's be so very happy.